to South Georgia to do Christmas with my grandmother. And one of the things that would happen, of course, is you would get a gift. And if you remember visiting grandparents' house and maybe they gave gifts, that one of the things that would usually happen with me the moment that I got my gift is I would shake the gift or move it around. And the reason why I would shake that present or move it around is I wanted to know something about the inside. And usually for me, and maybe you've experienced this too, that if you hear like a clink and a clang, it usually means that there's something cool inside. And I wanted maybe like, you know, a Nerf gun. I wanted maybe a video game system or something like that. But every time I opened up a gift from my grandmother, there was no clinking and there was no clanging. There was only swooshing. And you didn't want to hear swooshing because guess what that meant you usually got? Socks. Yeah, that's exactly right, is that you would get socks or undershirts or a turtleneck. Now, please understand, I'm not trying to be ungrateful, and I'll share with you in a little bit how God, I believe, changed my heart. But I would hear about my buddies right after Christmas when I would show up at school with my turtleneck. They would tell me that their grandmother got them, you know, a video game system or maybe a Nerf gun or a remote control car. And so whenever I would open up this gift, I would look at it, and a lot of times I would think, man, I wish I so bad could change what was inside of that box. I wish that I got something different. Maybe you felt that way when you've opened up a gift, or maybe you've thought that way when you've looked in the mirror. You look in that mirror, and you think about what other people have, but you miss what you have, and you say, man, I wish so bad I got something different. I wish there was something different inside of there. It's easy, isn't it, to fixate kind of on our gaps or our deficiencies and to miss on what God has blessed us with. See, that's exactly what happens in the Bible in 1 Samuel 9 when we meet a guy named Saul. Saul was gifted. And what was so amazing about Saul is that God called him, God gifted him, and other people could see the gifts and the calling that was on Saul's life, but like a lot of us, Saul missed it. Because isn't it easier to see what God has blessed other people with, but to forget and to miss what he has done and worked inside of you? And so what happens is we start out in 1 Samuel 9, and it's a very unique situation, but here's what I want you to see as we frame the text this morning, that the situation Saul finds himself in shows that God's thumbprint is on his life. And the situation I want you to see as you reflect on this with you to see that God's thumbprint is on your life too. So here's what's happening. Saul's dad evidently has a ton of donkeys. The donkeys go missing. He goes chasing after these donkeys, and he brings with him one of his servants. And so while they're out searching for these donkeys, what ends up happening is the servant and Saul have this conversation where Saul says, listen, we've been searching for these donkeys for a really long time. I think Dad's going to start to worry about me, so we probably need to head back. The donkeys are valuable, but I'm probably more valuable in his eyes. And the servant says, well, how about this? There's this guy. His name's Samuel. He's a seer. Samuel knows what's going on. So maybe what we can do is ask Samuel where the donkeys might be, and he could direct us in the right way. And Saul says, well, that's a great idea, but the problem is if you go to somebody like that and you ask them for something, what they're going to want is like a thank you gift. You know, they're going to want a thank you card of some kind. Do we have anything on us? And they start looking around in their luggage. They start looking around in their stuff. They have no bread. They have no special gift. But all of a sudden, the servant reaches down in his pocket. He's like, hey, I got a coin. We'll just give him this coin. So they show up, and they go on this trip headed to see Samuel the seer. Well, here's what's so amazing about this. Samuel ends up having a one-on-one with God where God comes to him and says, hey, tomorrow there's going to be a Benjamite that shows up at your place. Saul was a Benjamite. And he said, and when you see him, he's going to be the next king of Israel. And so what happens is Saul and his servant, they show up at the house and they're like, hey, we're trying to find the seer here. And so what ends up happening is the seer says, that's me. I'm the one you're looking for. And so Samuel's like, thank you. We've been looking for you because we can't find our donkeys anywhere. And I love in the text how Samuel's like, hey, forget about your donkeys, man. Like, they've been gone for 3 days. Now they're gone. What I want you to focus on is the gift and the blessing God is about to put on your life. You came here searching for donkeys, but I'm about to put a crown on you. The reason why I want to stop here for just a second is I want you to notice something. It was absolutely no accident that Samuel lived where he lived. It was no accident that that servant had a coin in his pocket. It was no accident that Saul's dad had a bunch of donkeys, and it was no accident that those donkeys got lost. Do you see what's happening? That God was in on the details. And the reason I want to mention that to you is I want you to know that you are no accident. That it's no accident that you are here on this earth. It's no accident that you are here on this campus. God is in on the details of your life. But as you're going to see with Saul, it's not just about your arrival. You're made for even more than that. But isn't it kind of cool that he is having one of those days where he's just doing a normal task? And we all have those, you know, donkey chasing days when we're going after something, doing something normal. And does that not bring value to every single moment of what God can do behind the scenes? Because I know for me, I used to always think that the moments God shows up in the most is those big moments, you know? That the power of God is relegated to a few like core memories. But this text tells us that the prize of life is not in what you do just occasionally, it's what you do daily when you see that God is in on it. Like, I hope you see it was no accident that you got here. And you might look at it and you see it now, you might see it later. Just like it was no accident that Saul shows up to be crowned king, it is no accident that God has put a crown on you. Like I said, I don't know what got you here, but I want you to see that you were made for more than just arriving here. So what ends up happening is Samuel anoints Saul to be king. And it's an amazing scene. He pours that ointment over his head. And I think it's so amazing. He shows up trying to find a lost donkey, but God ends up giving this man the keys to the kingdom. Now, when you look at Saul's profile, I don't have time to get into all of it, but it says in the text that the Spirit of the Lord rushed on him, means that God had called him to this position. 1 Samuel 9, verse 1 says that he was tall and he was handsome. That means he was gifted for this spot. See, when the Bible mentions height, it's not referring to necessarily your height. It is and it isn't. Because during this day, when someone was usually a tall person, it was a sign that they were in a leadership position or they were being trained to be in that. So his height has a lot to do with, yes, his physical ability, but it also has a lot to do with his future. But the other thing is this, other people, as you start to notice in the text, they can see it in him. But again, the problem for Saul is he doesn't see it in himself. If you are a child of God, I want you to know you have been called by God. And jobs are great, but calling is greater. God has called every single one of us to love the Lord our God with all of our heart and our soul and our mind and to love our neighbor as ourselves. The job that you will get one day, that vocation is how you're going to maybe further that, to bring the gospel into your workplace. But doesn't that change it from, hey, occasionally God's going to do something great to daily God can do something great? But the other thing is you're gifted for it. In purpose-driven life, they have this acrostic that I really like. It's the acrostic shape. And it says every single human being has a shape, and that is this, a spiritual gift, S. That every person has, H, a heart for something. That means that maybe you watch the news and you hear about the orphan crisis in America, your heart breaks for that. That maybe some of you hear about the fact that there's certain parts of the world that don't have clean drinking water and it hurts your heart. So what happens with you is your heart moves in that direction. You have a heart for something. A, abilities. P, a perspective. You can see the world in a way that no one else sees it because you are uniquely designed by God. I love what Ephesians 2:10 says, that you are God's workmanship. You're created in Christ Jesus. And he said, you're not an afterthought. This was something God had planned a long time ago for you to do good works. And then E, that you have all had different experiences. See, what you have gone through, the good and the bad, that God can use that to help minister to other people that will go through good and bad. That even in your misery, that misery can be something that one day is used as a ministry for you as you use that experience and help walk people through the very thing that you went through. Do you see Saul's profile? Do you see your profile? But again, the problem for Saul, just like us, sometimes we fail to see it. What are you going to do with that calling? What are you going to do with that gift? Well, let's see what Saul did. It says in the text that they're kind of having like this, almost like his coronation. They're having his unveiling ceremony to welcome him as king. And if you look in the very last part of this verse, it says they were looking for him and they could not find him. And then I see this next part in the text truly humorously. It says, they like, hey, is there another person that's supposed to come? And it says this, Saul has hidden himself among the baggage. Now, keep in mind, he's a really tall guy, so this is kind of foolish that, you know, they wouldn't, he wouldn't think that they could actually see him. And that word baggage is a really interesting word in the Hebrew. It's like the word Kelly. And the idea of this word, it implies baggage that it could be accessories, it could be jewelry, it could be weaponry. There's a national convention that's about to happen. It could be some stuff associated with that. But the Bible is purposefully saying we don't know what the baggage is. And I think that's purposeful because the important thing to ask for Saul is not what it is that you're hiding behind, but why are you hiding? And I want you to think about that for you. What are you hiding behind? Like, God's given you gifts. God's given you abilities. Maybe for some of you, you hide behind your athletic or academic abilities. Maybe you hide behind a certain accomplishments or status. We've all hidden behind something. The question is not what you're hiding behind, but why are you hiding? There's a lot of debate as to why he was hiding. Some think he was shy. He was trying to remain humble. My trouble with that theory is right before the text, God says you can step out and do it, and then afterwards we start to see some behavior from him that doesn't really seem to me indicative of somebody that's really ready to go forward. However, he does have some strong moments, but I want to ask you that same question. It's not about what you're hiding behind, but why are you hiding? I think for some of us, maybe it's talent comparison. Like, we see what other people have, and so we miss what we have. And I'll go ahead and tell you that one of the quickest ways to kill contentment in your life is through comparison. When I was in middle school, I played football. Well, let me say, I was on a football team, and there's a big difference between the two of those. So I was on a football team, and Coach McBrayer, this was over at ACA, on the first day of practice, he said, all right, here's what I want to do. I want to line you boys up, and I'm going to take notes about which position you guys would like to play or what you've played. And I've never played football before. And so he gets to me, he's like, Itson, what would you like to play? And I was like, wide receiver. He's like, okay, all right, sounds good, you know. And so he, that very first practice, he tells me to run a five and out. So I get the five, but I never get out. And the reason why I don't get out is there's a boy in our grade named Robert. And Robert in middle school was like 180 pounds and had armpit hair. He was way ahead of everybody else. And so I ran, and I never remember anything else except for Robert trucking me. And I'll never forget Coach, you know, pulled me to the side. He's like, hey, hang in there, man. That's going to happen in football. He said, but I did have a question for you. Don't you play soccer? I was like, oh, yeah, I love soccer. He's like, I think you're just going to be the kicker. So, you know, there's certain things in people's lives that they feel like they don't have what that person has, and they truly don't, but then it causes them to miss the reality of what they have. Talent comparison is so incredibly dangerous, and here's why it's dangerous. Comparison in general, it doesn't matter if it's luxuries or talents, is sinful because here's the thing. Comparison either makes you feel superior to somebody or inferior to somebody, and neither of those things honor God. So maybe that's part of the issue is you're comparing what you have to what other people have. Maybe for some of you it's your past. See, you know what you've done, but that's not really the problem. It's the fact that you know other people know about what you've done. And so because of that, we think, well, no one could take me serious. God couldn't use somebody like me. And so because we have that mentality sometimes, we miss out on the freedom that comes with calling when God has already redeemed what we will not move forward in. Does that make sense? that we base a lot of our ability and our choice to use our gifts and our talents more on gossip than the gossip circle, gospel, I mean. And so the problem is Jesus says, listen, I've forgiven you. He says you're a royal priesthood, you're a holy nation, you're God's special possession. That's what he says to God's children. We have to see ourselves as that. Maybe for some of you it's fear. I know that was the big deal for me because I used to think, well, what if I go out and try and it does not go well? Did you know that one of the greatest signs of a good leader is somebody that will try something and they will fail? That there's actually fruit even in failing at times. Don't let fear lead to the tragedy of an unopened gift. When you open a gift, there's always a risk, but I'm saying it's a risk willing to take. Maybe for some of you, it's just laziness. That God's gifted you, but you know if you do something in that, there's going to be something required of you. I don't know what it is, but I want to ask you again, what are you going to do with your gift? What happens with Saul is the people come up to him, they're like kind of lifting him on their shoulders as if it were like, all right, let's go, we got this. And so he goes and he has this amazing victory against the Ammonites. But we've all experienced in our life, right, that sometimes right after the highest of high, we can experience the lowest of low, right? And so Samuel, that seer, comes up to him and says, hey, listen, man, awesome victory, wonderful thing. But one of the things that I know that can oftentimes happen is that people can start to get a little comfortable with an earthly king, that they forget their heavenly one. And also, when you experience a victory, it's easy to forget the one that got you there. So just be careful. Like, don't let the victory become about you, and don't let the victory take away from what God's doing. And the same thing for us, right? It's easy in life when we experience success, when we experience growth, to forget the God that got us there. Well, that's exactly what starts to happen with Saul. Right after they have this amazing victory, they're wanting to offer up a praise and a sacrifice to God. Samuel says, hey, I'm going to be there in a second. That's my gift. That's what God has called me to do. And so Saul is waiting for Samuel to show up, and he's waiting. And he's waiting. And it doesn't happen on his timetable. And so what he says is, well, what I'm going to do is I'm just going to offer up the sacrifice without Samuel's help. And so, of course, that's not what God had asked him to do. And here's the reason why he did it. Because he wanted to seem like he was in control to his soldiers. He wanted to seem like he had everything together. Do you see this pattern of what starts to happen within him? He didn't heed the warning. Let's think about the one that got me to the victory. He started to think about himself. So as you know, there's a guy that is named David. You know, the one that took the stones and the sling and slayed that giant. He shows up on scene. And the ladies in town, which makes it even worse, they start to forget about him. And they start to focus on David. And they make this statement. Have y'all heard about that David guy? You know, we talk about Saul killing his thousands, but David, I mean, he's killed his tens of thousands. And the text says that when Saul hears this, he gets angry, and the text goes on to say that he positioned himself in life to want to do something about it. He wanted to put it to an end. If you've killed thousands or tens of thousands, you're still using your abilities, right? Because here's the danger of comparison. Comparison also leads to something very dangerous, and it's this. It's covetousness. See, what happened with Saul is Saul wanted to have what David had, the status, the view, how other people saw him, and it caused him not just to miss on what God gave him, but here's what it did. It made him angry. So I want you to think about this for just a second. Here's this guy. He was called to it. He was gifted for it. And other people could see it, but all he could focus on was what he didn't have. And so in comes this guy named David, and I noticed something about David that's different than Samuel and Saul, excuse me. Whenever David goes through a difficulty, which he will, whenever David fails, which he will, and whenever David experiences success, which he will, his reaction to the failures of life and the success in life was very different than Saul's. See, what you're going to see is that when Saul sees what other people have, it shows up that he forgot to pack something in his baggage. See, David, in the moments of success, but also in the moments of difficulty, you'll see that David resorts to a harp. Isn't it interesting that during a difficult moment, during an awesome moment, that he knows that God still needs to get that praise. But what does Saul carry with him during the difficult moment? Well, he carries a spear. You see what's happening here? You got David that's carrying a harp, Saul that's carrying a spear. And I used to think of the spear as the weapon and the harp is just an instrument. But what if the harp was actually the weapon? That he knew that the only way you can move forward in life and the only way you can achieve what God wants you to achieve is if God is getting the glory. Do you see what I'm saying? The harp is what keeps you humble. And so you might think, well, I know, but I need to know what's happening next. That's called control, okay? Keep your hand on the harp. God is going to keep his hand on the spear. He's going to take care of what's ahead of you, but you just need to remain humble. When I look at the main issue with Saul, it's this. I think in his life, he prioritized charisma and what other people think more than character. I don't know what got you here, but I do know, just like Saul experiences, you were made for more than just arriving here. That God has given every single one of you a shape. He's called you to something. He's gifted you for something. And the fact that you're here at Faulkner shows that other people have actually seen it. What are you going to do with the gifts that God has given you? And I think about, for me, maybe you've seen this in your own life, just like Saul, it's easy to forget the one that got you there. And so I want to remind you that when you do experience success, but also when you experience difficulty, keep your hand on the harp. Because what's going to happen is that that talent that you have, it will grow in the ground of humility. You know, it's interesting, that gift that I used to kind of be bummed by from my grandmother, as I got older, I started to appreciate those socks and those undershirts and that turtleneck. And the reason why I started to appreciate it is, see, my grandma, for a lot of my childhood, she was a widow. She had no expendable income. In fact, I remember my parents telling me that she would actually go in the backyard and she would, they had a bunch of pecan trees. She would use those pecans and pick them up to turn them in to get money just to buy our Christmas gifts. See, when I started to learn something about the gift giver, I started to better appreciate the gift. What I'm saying is God has put an enormous investment on you. He loves you so much. He gave his son up for you. And so when you start to see and to better understand through God's word and those Bible classes and these chapels that you have, the gift giver, you're going to better understand the power that you have in your gifts. God loves you. I love you. We all know that, but you also need to see that.